Well, good morning and welcome as we come before the Lord to worship and to praise His name. I want to thank you too for giving me a week of vacation last week, and I'll have some others coming up yet too. We want to thank Dale for exhorting for me last week as well. My family and I, obviously we made it safely back. There were a variety of hurdles we had to go through as one of our flights was canceled and then everything went nuts after that. But we enjoyed our time, and really with a once-in-a-lifetime vacation down in Mexico. And so we, in Puerto Escondido, in beautiful city, beautiful area, kind of a small town and not a touristy town. So, but anyway, a variety of announcements here. Just as we look at this week, Peace Villa, the calendar got messed up there. So next week is what's on the calendar for my going ahead and doing a Bible study there, so just kind of take note of that. And then also kind of note too, not only the youth group accepting donations for summer pick and pack event, there are a lot of families that are, because of the cost of what's going on and inflation and the struggles, the financial struggles in this nation, a lot of people are in need of that, and they're being helped by that. So keep that in mind. This month, the Confirm Now will begin going ahead and ushering. And just so you know, next week, it'll be, next Sunday, it'll be Tanner that'll be ushering. And the following week, it'll be Joe. Going down to for Stifton Fest Family Night, Thursday, August 25th. Everybody's welcome to come to that. This is a free night that the churches all put on, basically put a variety of things together. Hopefully if there's no storms this year, we'll finally get able to be able to use the ninja course for the kids and things like that. So it's a bunch of blow up stuff and should be pretty fun. We, as the Brotherhood, will be doing the root beer floats again. So anybody can help if you want, but we'll be giving out free root beer floats, and it's sponsored by Quick Trip. And so just kind of take note of that as well. We'll need a variety of helpers. That night, too, there's going to be a meeting. So I won't be at the meeting, but I'll be there for Stifton Fest for the family night. Going down here for prayer and praise notes, Aaron would like to thank everyone for their prayers and cards after his surgery and as he recovers. Lance is recovering from his surgery, and he also wanted to give a word of thanks for everyone for their prayers and cards, too. And then take note, too, Bernetta fell on Thursday and has many injuries. You can see the details there. So we need to keep her in our prayers. She's in the hospital yet. And so, Lord willing, I'll get to see her today. Thursday, I have a meeting in Sioux Falls. Be in prayer for us, because really it may change a lot of things with Kenya. There's a lot of situations. Thankfully, this time I don't have to fly to Kenya. We have some other guys that will be going. But keep us in your prayers as well. And a reminder, Shelby and Kevin, they've struggled to have a baby, and they're having a fundraiser on this Saturday and at 3. So anybody's welcome there as well, or if you want to assist them too, you can always even put it in the offering plate and with a designation towards them as well. And then a praise note I should include, even though I did not include it here, is my daughter Abby is engaged, and so they're getting married December 10th. And so Marie and I and the family rejoice in that too. So, well, let's prepare our hearts and minds to come before the Lord and worship, and let us do that through silent prayer. Let's stand as God calls us to worship, taken from Psalm 33, which says, "Rejoice in the Lord, O you righteous, for praise from the upright is beautiful. Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of him. For he spoke and it was done. He commanded and it stood fast. The Lord brings the counsel of the nations to nothing. He makes the plans of the people of no effect. The counsel of the Lord stands forever, the plans of his heart to all generations." One of the things, a wonderful thing that the gospel or the scripture shows us is part of the plans of God's heart is to forgive our sins and to redeem us. And it's for that reason we come and worship him and we stand before him, even as he calls us into his presence, saying, Beloved of Christ, called to be saints, grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Almighty God and most gracious Heavenly Father, as we come before you this morning, make us to know how truly yours is all the glory. You are the one who is worthy of our praise. This is not about ourselves. This is not about what we may even get out of it, but we are here to praise and worship your name, to remember your blessings to us, and to give thanks to your holy name. Help us to see that, because particularly in this life, we are distracted to think the glory is ours, or even that we're the center of the universe. And no matter what we can grab, even the greatest treasure of this world is but a vain counterfeit of the glory, which is yours. The glories of this world, or seeming glories of this world, last but for a moment. Help our eyes now to desire your praise with the words of our mouth, as well as with our lives, through fear and reverence. And help us to hear your word and rejoice in your good grace to us, which you have given to us freely for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ. Help us to give glory to you now this morning. Amen.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, it's now and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Amen.
Let us confess our faith together now using the words of the Apostles' Creed. Christians, what do you believe?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the holy universal Christian church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please be seated and let us open up our hymnals now to hymn 65, as we sing before Jehovah's awesome throne, and it's based on Psalm 100, hymn number 65.
Brought us to his fold again. Almighty Maker, to your name. Almighty Maker, to your name. We'll crowd your gates with thankful song. I ask the heavens, our voices raise, and earth.
Let's turn in God's word to Matthew 28 and verses 16 through 20. And we'll read the brief passage responsibly here this morning. I'm doing a short series here for the next two Sundays dealing with looking at missions or dealing with looking at what our purpose is really. Again, it's easy for us to think of missions as something about going abroad, going to some distant land, but we'll see something else here in this well-known command of Christ and his great commission. So I'll read the even verses. You as a congregation will read the odd verses. And found on page 881 in your pew Bibles. Then the 11 disciples went away into Galilee to the mountain which Jesus had appointed to them. And when he saw them, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth.
Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit,
teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." Let's turn now in the back of our bulletin to Lord's Day 30, as we also go back to the confession, which keeps us grounded in God's Word and reminds us of the basics of the faith that we cling to. And Lord's Day 30, questions 80 and 80 through 82 deal with the Lord's table and particularly even some of the perversions of the Lord's table according to the doctrine of a different church. And question 80, again, may not be what everybody in the pew believes, but this is according, this was a response to the Council of Trent. Question 80, what difference is there between the Lord's Supper and the Pope's Mass? The Lord's Supper testifies to us that we have full forgiveness of all our sins by the one sacrifice of Jesus Christ, which he himself once accomplished on the cross, and that by the Holy Spirit we are engrafted into Christ, who with his true body is now in heaven at the right hand of the Father and is there to be worshipped. But the Mass teaches that the living and the dead do not have forgiveness of sins through the sufferings of Christ, unless Christ is still daily offered for them by the priests, and that Christ is bodily under the form of the bread and wine, and is therefore to be worshipped in them. And thus the Mass, and nothing else, is a denial of the one sacrifice and suffering of Jesus Christ and an accursed adultery. Who are to come to the table of the Lord? Those who are displeased with themselves for their sins, yet trust that these are forgiven them, and that their remaining infirmity is covered by the suffering and the death of Christ, who also desire more and more to strengthen their faith
and to amend their life. But the unrepentant and hypocrites eat and drink judgment to themselves. Are they then also to be admitted to the supper who show themselves by their confession and life to be unbelieving and ungodly? No, for thereby the covenant of God is profaned, and his wrath is provoked against the whole congregation. Therefore, the Christian church is bound, according to the order of Christ and his apostles, to exclude such persons by the office of the keys until they amend their life. These catechisms are really here, understand, to encourage us, to encourage those who are weak in faith, of the once and for all perfect sacrifice of Christ, which Hebrews 10:10 speaks of. There's always a temptation in our life, either to think that we need something more, or even as one denomination or group, they make sure, and I remember this years ago, because I did a lot of work in Chicago for this denomination, and they made sure the Lord's Supper was offered every day, and because they felt that was part of their salvation. As the priest talked with me, they brought that up. But what this one of the things we need to understand is these catechisms are doing what the scripture does and encouraging you and I of what the purpose of the Lord's table is for. It's not there to make hypocrites feel comfortable. We are not, as Paul writes in Romans, to sin that grace may abound. But we're called to repent of our sin. And the reality is, there is not one of you and not me that does not struggle with our sin. Paul talks about that even in Romans 7. That's part of the Christian life, because many times the things that we desire not to do, we may do. Paul said, describes his own life that way. And there's not many symbols. I mean, God's given us his word and his promises, but that word, and part of that word and that promise too, is in the symbol, the sign and seal of the Lord's Supper, which is here to remind us, as the catechism says, that our remaining infirmities, that our sins are forgiven, and that our remaining infirmities are continued to struggle in this life, because we will falter and fail. But as Christians, as God's people, as his elect, and that's the point of election, is to assure us. It's not for us to wonder, okay, is my name written in the Lamb's book alive? It is there to encourage us. As our faith is weak, as we stumble, that we will not ultimately fall headlong, but the Lord will forgive us and he will redeem us. And that even as Christ suffered that one time on the cross, he did that for our past and present, and even our future sins. And that Lord's table, the Lord's Supper, is there to strengthen our faith so that we continue and don't grow weak in a life of repentance and faith. And so we should understand these catechisms, really, these three catechisms, even though sometimes attacked and things like that, the reality is these are here to encourage us. That you and I have a gracious Savior. And the only thing we can do, ultimately, in the end, is to offer the sacrifice of a praise from our lips, as Hebrews 13:15 calls us to do. Because you and I have the finished work of Christ Jesus, which is your and my sure hope to continue to live, as frail as we do in this life, to live knowing your sins and my sins are forgiven. And it encourages us even there, too. I should say it again. And we can't live in our sins. We have to repent of them, no matter what they are. Otherwise, we're hypocrites. But there is that encouragement that we have God's grace. Let's go before the Lord now in prayer, remembering the words from 1 Peter 1:17.
which says, "And if you call on the Father, who without partiality judges according to each one's work, conduct yourselves throughout the time of your stay here in fear, knowing that you are not redeemed with corruptible things like silver and gold from your aimless conduct received by traditions from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ as a lamb without blemish and without spot. He indeed was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but he was manifested in these last times for you who through him believe in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God." Let's pray. Almighty God and most gracious Heavenly Father, we come before you. Indeed, our faith and our hope is in you. We can't look at our own thoughts. We can't look at and find you. We have to look to your word. We have to be changed and transformed by your word. And we need that every day because even as you've said, your thoughts are not our thoughts, neither are your ways our ways. Because as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are your ways higher than our ways and your thoughts than our thoughts. Because while we like excusing maybe our sin or even our pet sins, reality is you tell us to forsake our way, to forsake our unrighteous thoughts. And Lord, particularly too, in this time, we live in such a perverse age, and help us to understand that neither can we embrace our own ideas, nor can we embrace the ideas of the world, because the gospel dictates the truth and not the culture. It doesn't matter what the world says is acceptable, because you have declared what is true and what is right, what is just. You also have declared your mercy to us. And you, Lord, are not a respecter of persons. You judge without partiality. And the reality is, we stand before you as a holy God, not one of us is righteous. The only way we can stand before you is in the righteousness of your Son, who has redeemed us not with the corruptible things, not with the treasures of this world, but with his holy and righteous and precious blood on the cross. And we thank you for that, Lord. Help us to see that you are a compassionate and forgiving God, because immediately, too often, we always think there's something more that needs to be done, whether by ourselves or by another. And yet you are the God who tells us as we return to you that you will have compassion on us. And you are the God who abundantly pardons, and we thank you for that, Lord. Strengthen us in the knowledge of that grace, because again, this world is not all that there is. This world is passing away, and yet you have not abandoned us in this world. You care for us in our struggles and in our trials, and even you bless us in a variety of ways, even amidst our trials. Help us to see that, Lord. We know many of your people are recovering from surgeries, and we pray that you would strengthen them. We know there's many struggles, and we pray particularly for Bernetta right now. As trials have just come over her now, and wave after wave, and we pray that you would grant her your healing care. But most of all, we pray that you would strengthen her faith, because ultimately our purpose is not to live either a trouble-free life or even to live forever in this fallen world. And thankfully, Lord, you barred the way to the tree of life so that we would not live forever in our sin or in this frail body. You gave us your Son to live and die, and die for our sin, and to rise again to give us life eternal. And we look forward, Lord, to that new heavens and new earth. We are eager for that time. But we pray again, strengthen Bernetta, strengthen her family, and strengthen those too going through trials in the church, even many that are not even listed in this bulletin. And we pray that you would strengthen your people and bless them, and even to bless your people with children so that they can raise them up to glorify you. Lord, again, we thank you that you are a merciful God. Help us to realize too and to rejoice in that mercy so that we proclaim it to others, that we would be a witness in this of the light of your gospel in this dark and dying world, so that your name would be glorified. Help us see that's our purpose. We don't live this life for ourselves, but you have sovereignly placed us in this world to be your tools, to be used by you to spread the gospel. And we thank you, too, for missionaries that we have, that we support, that do that. But help us to see our purpose, too, is to be salt and light in this world in which we live. Strengthen us in that, Lord, now. Even as we pray and join our voices together in prayer, which Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Well, let's stand as we sing the song from the songbook, number 13, Wonderful, Merciful Savior, song number 13. Please be seated and turn with me now in God's Word to 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. And I do this every once in a while, and I, I don't want to do it at the same time. We have our mission fast, but it is important to remember what Christ is commanding us. And we see through the example of Paul, he kind of lays out his ministry because he had a lot of different accusations coming at him. And so he gives us the example, really, not just for the ministry, but even how we disciple others, because that's really what his life is doing. He's coming alongside these Christians. He's discipling them. That's what I'm to do as a pastor, and I strive to do that, but I know I also fall short. But Paul is laying out here his purpose. We're going to read, really, the first six verses this time, then we'll look at the next verses, but I'll go ahead and read the whole passage to verse 12. For you yourselves know, brethren, that our coming to you was not in vain. But even after we had suffered before and were spitefully treated at Philippi, as you know, we are bold in our God to speak to you the gospel of God in much conflict. For our exhortation did not come from error or uncleanliness, nor was it in deceit. But as we have been approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel, even so we speak, not as pleasing men, but God who tests our hearts. For neither at any time did we use flattering words, as you know, nor a cloak of covetousness for covetousness. God is witness. Nor did we seek glory from men, either from you or from others, when we might have made demands as apostles of Christ. But we were gentle among you, just as a nursing mother cherishes her own children. So affectionately longing for you, we were well pleased to impart to you not only the gospel of God, but also our own lives, because you have become dear to us. For you remember, brethren, our labor and toil, for laboring night and day, that we might not be a burden to any of you, we preach to you the gospel of God. You are witnesses in God also, how devoutly and justly and blamelessly we behaved ourselves among you who believe. As you know, we exhorted and comforted and charged every one of you, as a father does his own children, that you would walk worthy of God, who calls you into his own kingdom and glory. Grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our God stands forever. O beloved congregation of the Lord Jesus Christ, as Western society is rejecting God and his word, you think of problems are hitting us like the unending ocean waves that come and batter a beach. And the question that we automatically wonder then, what must we do in this age? Are we to hunker down? Are we to pull in? Are we to be overwhelmed as Satan is clearly active? The answer is no. Because God is sovereignly turning and working all things to fulfill his good pleasure in blessings as well as in times of judgment. And God often, you think about it, often, look at the page of the scripture, we often see it was times of trials and even times of chastening where God worked more clearly, or God opened the door to the preciousness of his gospel. I mean, isn't that why David, one of my favorite verses over the last 3 years even, it's why David cried out in the psalmist, he says, when my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that's higher than I. And that rock, our stability in a time like today and with the struggles we face, even our own sins, that rock is our triune God, his covenant promise, his redeeming work and righteousness through Christ his Son, which also includes in this is the fact that we don't have to live here forever. There will be one day that Christ will return and he will judge and he will set everything right. And he will bring his children to eternal blessedness with him. Knowing this, it is not meant to make us sit back. Because the reason Christ even says that all authority on earth and heaven and earth has been given to him is so that we would be propelled. So that we would be encouraged, even as daunting as what's going on in the world is, so that we would be encouraged to do what Christ commands. Go, therefore, and make disciples And no one is to be left out because he says of all nations. Whenever we think of missions, oftentimes it's easy for us to kind of exclude ourselves and to think, you know, missions is about something done in some foreign land. Or to think, well, Pastor, that's for you. I've gone to Africa 3 times. But Christ's command shows us really missions is just discipling others, coming alongside of others with the word of God. And really, if you want to boil it down, you could even say it's loving our neighbor enough to want them to know and love the triune God and his word, to be saved by faith in Christ alone, and then to desire that the Holy Spirit would work in them and that they would reflect Christ more and more in their life. Now again, to desire that for somebody else, we need to desire that in our own life. But again, understand this command that was given by Christ to all the disciples that were there, not just the 12, to remind us it's not just the duty of pastors and church officers. It's not just merely the duty of a godly parent for their children, but each one of us must desire to disciple others in this lost and dying world. There's a lot of people around you and I that need to hear the gospel. We need to hear it again. Because if God doesn't work in their heart, they have an eternity, a suffering hell. Now, to help us understand what discipleship means, Paul here is defending his work as a pastor. But in that too, it's teaching us this morning two important aspects about discipleship. We'll look at some others too as well. But first is that our purpose is to disciple others, focusing on God's word. You know, we often think, what do I say to somebody else? Well, point them to God. Point them to his word. Not our thoughts about God, but his word. And secondly, we are to disciple in such a way as to please and glorify God from the heart. That's what we're called to do. Something we often teach our children, and that is the phrase, sticks and stones may break our bones, but words will never hurt me. Yet the reality is gossip and slanderous accusations do hurt. Especially when those you love begin to believe what's said. And that's where Paul is kind of dealing with that issue, because the Thessalonican church, as small as it was starting to believe some of the lies that were told about Paul. And remember how this all kind of came about. Paul received, miraculously, a Macedonian call. And so he goes to Macedonia, first to Philippi. And there in Philippi, as Acts 16 shows us, he preaches the gospel, which shuts down the idol factory and led to his persecution and to his arrest. And then he goes to Thessalonica. And he's going to talk. And we looked at verse 9 even there a little bit. And many turned from their idols to the living God. And Acts 17 shows us all those events. But there were many Jews that were jealous of the gospel's popularity and didn't like Paul. And they attacked him and followed him from Philippi even to Thessalonica. And they incited so much violence against the gospel, against Paul, that Paul had to be snuck out of the city at night over the wall in a basket. And after he was gone, the enemies of the gospel and even some in the church began to twist the words and rewrite history. So the Apostle Paul, out of love for these young Christians, to defend his ministry and really to defend the gospel, so they didn't drift away from it, he writes this. And really teaches us also about discipling others. And it starts first with our purpose is to disciple others by focusing on God's word. Look at verse 1. He says, for you yourselves know, brethren, you're a witness to these things, that our coming to you was not in vain. Think about this. Paul was literally only there for 3 Sabbaths. That's kind of a short time, isn't it? And yet Jews, Greeks, and devout women, the scripture tells us, all were brought by God to faith. Why? Because of the preaching of the gospel. And I think, I know this is countercultural today, but the preaching of the gospel is never an empty act. It's not about light, sound, and smoke, and things like that, and about being entertaining. Because Paul is teaching us, the preaching of the gospel is never an empty act. I mean, ask yourself here, what would mark success here at St. Paul's? Paul says he doesn't point to the conversions, those three Sundays. He doesn't even point to the conflict. He doesn't point to programs or numbers. But his point is, the reason the ministry there was not in vain was because the word of God was preached. The promises of God were unpacked and reminded of the people, or at least revealed to the people. And then he adds, but even after we had suffered before and were spitefully treated at Philippi. And here's the thing, it's easy after we've been persecuted to kind of pull back, isn't it? Paul doesn't do that. He keeps going forward. He says, we were bold in our God. Boldness was not in himself, but in God, to speak to you the gospel of God in much conflict. Why was he bold? Well, the gospel wasn't from Paul. I still remember a college class where we were studying the Bible, and even I've read critical books of the Bible too, and everybody sits there, well, you know, really the gospel is what Paul wrote. But notice how Paul describes this. He talks about the gospel of God. And if you really read Paul's writings, everything points back to what Jesus has said. Everything points back to what was promised in the Old Testament. The gospel didn't originate with Paul. It originates with God. And so to reject God's word, to change the message, to make it look better to a fallen world, and that's something that's very possible, popular today. I've read many quotes of pastors where I just shake my head. But to reject God's word is to reject, and this is not a small error, because to reject God's word is to reject the true and living God. To sit there and say, you know, well, you know, God created the world. He makes sure that the very cells in your body are organized and the atoms in your body stay together. But you know, God, I don't like what you say here. So I think I know something better. How foolish is that? We can't change the message. We can't avoid the scripture to make it look better to a fallen world. This is God's word. Jesus even warns in John 12 that the word will judge those who reject him. The gospel is essential. And the gospel is not about our earning God's favor or climbing our way up to him. That's what every false religion teaches. The gospel of God teaches we as undeserving sinners are saved from the judgment we deserve by grace through faith in Christ's righteousness alone. And it's something God has done in completion. Which is why we give thanks to him and live for him. Because really it is an incredible thing. But it's to the one who does not work but believes in him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is credited as righteousness. That's not a popular message. It seems like it should be. But this is the message of Christ. What did Jesus teach in the parable, the Pharisee and the tax collector? The Pharisee thanks God, looks up to heaven and says, well, I thank you, I'm better than this other scumbag over here, this tax collector. Think about what the tax collector did. He wouldn't even look to heaven. He beat his chest. He said, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. What did Jesus say? Jesus said the tax collector went down to his house justified. Why? Because God saves humble, repentant sinners. And I pray each one of us is that. And what's the problem with that before the world? Speak about this confronts self-righteous people's pride. The Jews wanted to believe they, in Jesus' day, and in Paul's day, wanted to believe that they saved themselves. They were like the Pharisees. what happens today? Well, now what's happening today in pride is people downplay what God defines as sin. Let's change the meaning. Let's rewrite history. Let's make sin sound good and even noble. And if you don't accept that my sin, then you are a pariah on society. You're the problem. Listen, you hear that message over and over. But as Christians, we should understand that doesn't mean we should change the message. Even as people get angry and try to tighten the noose around Christians, what we're now seeing really is the sinfulness of sin. That sin actually is its own judgment, because we are seeing people speaking lies and hypocrisy, having their own conscience seared. They can't even see what's right in front of them. And Jesus warned about this. The one who brings us peace with God the Father said, "Do not think that I came to bring peace on the earth." Which kind of seems strange, because He's the Prince of Peace, right? He said, "I did not come to bring peace, but a sword." And what he's describing is the division the gospel will bring, the conflict it will bring. And it will upset some people. And you and I as Christians are called to come alongside of others and point them bit by bit, here a little, there a little, to the gospel. But know that the gospel brings conflict. It divides families even at times, because that's what Jesus will even say. It'll be, as another part of Scripture says, the essence of life, and God brings people to repentance and faith. For others, it's the essence of death, because they hate it. They hate having God placed his finger on their sin, and they will riot and strike out. That's what was happening in Paul's day. And it's happening in our day. Last year, angry Hindu mobs beat and murdered Christian pastors. Of course, the main news media will never talk about that. In China, as well as in Muslim countries, pastors are arrested. Have been arrested, even recently. Nigeria, the Christians in many places there are being just sorely persecuted and slaughtered. Of course, we don't hear about that. China, churches are being bulldozed. Crowds harass and the government arrests preachers for hurting people's feelings in Great Britain. Even in Canada, there have been some pastors who are arrested. The last couple of years. And this should not shock us. George Whitefield, he was a Reformed pastor in the First Great Awakening. He was not allowed to preach in a lot of churches, so what did he do? He went out and preached in fields, and there were thousands that gathered to hear the preaching of God's word. And since the gospel of Christ is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes, he didn't stop preaching, he kept preaching. And the amazing thing is many did, and the wonderful thing I should say is many did believe. God brought many to faith as he had planned. And yet Whitefield in this country and in England, he wrote of his persecution. He wrote this: "I was honored having stones, dirt, rotten eggs, and pieces of dead cat thrown at me." Not to give you an idea, any ideas. And I know you wouldn't have those. We live in a hostile world. But it does not mean we change our message. We cling to God's word. We proclaim God's word. And no matter what the world says, we need to do that. For his word is never in vain. And when we point to God's word, like we're to do in our families, even though sometimes it does seem vain, it will not be. God will always bless it. We just may not see how he does that. Well, secondly, our purpose is to disciple others to please and glorify God from our heart. Look at verse 3 through 4. He says, "For our exhortation did not come from error or uncleanliness, nor was it deceit." And he's talking about really the accusations that were brought against him for his preaching. And literally the word for deceit is the bait on a fishing pole, basically, to lure the fish in and until it's caught. Then he continues, though, but as we have been approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel, even so we speak, not as pleasing men, but God who tests our hearts. Why speak the unchangeable word of God when it offends others? I mean, we're being told that that's kind of the greatest sin. Don't offend others. In fact, there were some people in England that just got arrested for offending somebody on Facebook, something they said. Why not hold back from saying things then to a person or maybe a family member when it might offend? Well, the whole reason is because you and I are to be more concerned about pleasing God than offending. That happens. We're tempted by that. And Paul, again, is dealing with these accusations because the reality is, too, many twist the gospel. Many will use it to excuse immorality, or they weave error in it to make themselves sound more wise or hip. The old novel, and there's many that use it as a cloak for sin. There's an old novel that came out in 1920 that was rightfully ridiculing a sin that was in the church in this nation. It was a novel named Elmer Gantry. Showed preachers immorally were out there just to get women. The reality is, Paul's talking about here, God has entrusted us with the treasure of his word, which tells us what's right and what's wrong, and tells us the message of salvation in Christ's righteousness, not so that we can please ourselves, not so that we can indulge ourselves or bend it to make it more appealing to the world. The whole purpose of sharing the gospel in your family, with your neighbors and strangers, is to please God, who's given us the command. And not only that, he's entrusted this word to you and I because we are called to preserve and protect it. It's not that we're changing it, but we hold it out before the world as still being true, as still being applicable. It's not about holding it to the world to make it more palatable to it. I don't know if any of you have gone to this. Our family enjoyed this many years ago, but we went to the Coca-Cola Museum, and they make a big deal in Atlanta about their secret formula being in a vault. It's guarded so that to make sure the product is really ultimately consistent and unadulterated, and so that the enemy doesn't take it and use it. But in many ways, that's supposed to be true for the church as well. Not that we're hiding the message of the gospel at all. But God has given us his word. He has made us to be the pillar and the ground of church, of the truth. And God expects that we pass this on to the next generation and make sure that nobody changes it, to make sure that Christ is held high. This is passed on to generation after generation, and not adding our own ideas to it. Really, to maintain the integrity of the word preached. Because again, the Bible is not a wax nose to kind of turn wherever we wish. The confessions of the church also help us to avoid that temptation. It's not, because it's not ultimately about what pleases me. It's not ultimately about what pleases you so that you can go home and, you know, have a little roast pastor during lunch and talk about, well, I didn't really get it, or I didn't really hear it. It wasn't that entertaining. Now, what we're doing here is ultimately about pleasing God, about worshiping him. In the age we live in, with the persecution, which really is a lot less than what Paul went through, this is not a time to compromise, to compromise the gospel, to please others. For this is the faith once for all delivered to God's people. It's why Paul explains against the accusations in verse 5. He says, "For neither at any time did we use flattering words, as you know, nor a cloak for covetousness." Paul even takes an oath in this. God is my witness. God has been witness. He's here with us. And Paul's saying this because really it is a temptation. It's tempting to tell others what they want to hear. But God knows. He tests the hearts. And yes, there are hard things in Scripture, but we must never dodge them because God is our witness. And yes, some will fear the hard things will scare people away from God, but know that thinking is what Satan uses to make people believe the lies about God and start putting air in with what God says. That's why Paul makes it clear the preaching and discipling of others by the gospel is not about popularity or glory from men. Neither did they make demands and say, well, you know, I'm saying this because I'm an apostle. Because it's not about us. It's about God. Flattery, you think about it, is pleasing people to gain some sort of advantage, to get people to like us or think that we're smart or funny or whatever it may be. You and I have the purpose to speak to others about the things of God, to please God, knowing God is with us, knowing God is the one who turns hearts to repentance and hardens some hearts as he did Pharaoh. Now that doesn't mean we use the word of God like a brick to beat people up over the head. Next time we'll see that more. But for now, know our motives for discipling others with the gospel, with God's word, is to please and glorify him from the heart. Well, brothers and sisters in Christ, even in the church, there is a struggle to trust God's word. It's why we're often weak and not as bold as we should be as wave after wave of problems hits our nation and it's affecting the church. Are we going to cling to God's word? Are we going to disciple others by God's word? That's the question we have to ask ourselves. Before the Reformation, there was one pastor who really laid the groundwork, really, for the Reformation. And his name was John Huss. He treasured the Scripture, and he said, in them he found the gold of wisdom, the silver of eloquence, the gems of virtue, lavishly poured forth in heavenly grace. And this is why John Huss preached it, and could not be silent, even saying, in order that I may not make myself guilty by my silence, forsaking the truth for a piece of bread, or through the fear of men, I avow it to be my purpose to defend the truth which God has enabled me to know, and especially the truth of the Holy Gospel, even to death. And he said this because he desired to please God. And yes, it cost him his life. He was beheaded. His head actually was held on a pile or a post in Brussels for quite a while. What's your desire? Your conversations about the weather is about the twins, which actually are doing really well, obviously. We're thrilled with that. Are we concerned to make sure even we use those things to point to God's word? Because God hasn't called all of us to go to foreign lands. We are all to be discipling others with God's word. Charles Spurgeon said, the word of God is like a lion. Lion can defend itself. All you have to do is let it loose. It's not about us even being eloquent. Point to God's word. He will do the work. He will fulfill his plan of election. So may God make us people committed to focusing on his word, the power of the gospel, so that we may please and glorify him. Let's pray. Almighty God, most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for these words and for the power of the gospel by your Holy Spirit on all the pages, that all the words, that there's not one useless word in your word that we can get rid of or change or even bend. These are the words of life. So we thank you that you've sent your Son, Lord Jesus Christ, to redeem us, even according to all your word. Even to be among us right now, to bring about your plan of salvation by the preaching of your word, by using us as feeble as we are, as your tools, even as we disciple others that you providentially bring into our lives. We pray continue to be with us and bless us. Receive the worship we offer, not merely here, but with all of our life as we cling to your word and cling to you, our faithful Lord and Savior. We pray this in Jesus' name. Let's open up our hymnals now as we sing our offertory hymn, hymn number 447, Christ for the World We Sing, hymn number 447. Receive God's blessing as he sends us out by his grace. Now to him who is able to do exceedingly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us, to him be glory in the church by Jesus Christ to all generations, forever and evermore. Amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly hosts.